Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 136. O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Let's bow before him now in a moment of silent prayer, asking his blessing upon this service. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Grace, mercy, and peace be granted unto you from God the Father, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and by the operation of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Turn to 376. From Psalm 136, our call to worship. Think of Joshua when singing stanza 5. Let's sing now 1, 3, 4, and 5 of 376.
Thank you.
We'll read God's law this morning as it is found in Deuteronomy chapter 5. And in thinking about Joshua this morning, consider the fact that he was one of the Israelites who was there at Mount Sinai when the law was first given, and then also at the end of the 40 years of wilderness wandering when the law was given for the second time, right before entering the promised land. We'll read of that now in Deuteronomy chapter 5. I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Thou shalt have none other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the waters beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself unto them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Keep the Sabbath day to sanctify it, as the Lord thy God hath commanded thee. 6 days thou shalt labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thine ox, nor thine ass, nor any of thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates, that thy manservant and thy maidservant may rest, as well as thou. And remember that thou wast a servant in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord thy God brought thee out thence through a mighty hand and by a stretched out arm. Therefore, the Lord thy God commanded thee to keep the Sabbath day. Honor thy father and thy mother, as the Lord thy God hath commanded thee, that thy days may be prolonged, and that it may go well with thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill, neither shalt thou commit adultery, neither shalt thou steal, neither shalt thou bear false witness against thy neighbor. Neither shalt thou desire thy neighbor's wife. Neither shalt thou covet thy neighbor's house, his field or his manservant or his maidservant, his ox or his ass, or anything that is thy neighbor's. To Israel from Moses came this word of the Lord, the summary already in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 6, 4, and 5. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might. Let's take the Psalter and turn now to 292. As we sing 3 and 4, look for what the land of Canaan is called, what the Israelites thought of it as they anticipated it. Let's sing 1, 3, 4, and 5 of 292. Thank you. Let's worship God in congregational prayer. Great God and King, exalted in the highest heavens, we see thee now by faith, according to thy revelation to us in the Bible. We see thee high and lifted up, seated upon thy throne, around which are all the inhabitants of heaven, crying out and extolling and adoring thee with endless worship and praise. Before thy throne is the great sea of crystal, and everywhere is the radiation of thy glory. Thou art the majestic, sovereign, eternal, infinite, independent God, who is blessed forever. And we look up, and by faith we see the Lamb who was slain at thy right hand, the one and only one in the heavens above and the earth beneath, who is able to take thy sealed book and to loose the seals and open it for the unfolding of history and the fulfillment of thy counsel, so that all things are happening moment by moment now according to thy will and by the sovereign direction of the one to whom was given all authority and power in heaven and in earth, Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. And Father, there is so much confidence in us when we believe that everything is happening according to the direction of Jesus, and confidence that the white horse of the gospel is running triumphantly through this new dispensation, going forth conquering and to conquer, and that right now, on this the 3rd of March in the year of our Lord 2024, today, Jesus Christ, by his word and spirit, is going forth in all the earth, conquering and to conquer, here in this worship service and all throughout the world, so that nothing and no one can stop the gospel, and therefore no one can hinder the coming, the full coming of thy glorious kingdom. And Father, as we live here below on this earth, we are aware and we see the evidence of the running of the red horse. There is so much warfare, hatred, envy, desire for revenge, strife, murder, and contention everywhere in the earth and in our own nation too. And blood everywhere, the shedding of blood. And Lord, in the midst of all of the hatred and the warfare, we have peace in our souls as we behold thee on thy throne. And we see evidence too of the black horse of economic disparity running through the earth, so that there is constant strife between those who have and those who do not have, between those who live in poverty and those who fare sumptuously, and between political parties and adherents of different economic theories and ideologies and philosophies, constant strife and more threat of warfare. And the pale horse of death and the grave is constantly running, so that no matter who we are or where we go, there's always death. And Lord God Almighty, In the midst of all of the turmoil and the strife and the restlessness of the nations, and it's so obvious to us that the nations are restless and there is trouble everywhere, we're so glad this morning that we can confess in the full persuasion of faith that there's not one hair today that will fall from any head except it be according to thy will, and that every circumstance is being worked for the advantage of thy church, thy people, us. O thou sovereign Jehovah, who is a God like unto thee? Now this morning as we assemble for worship, speak powerfully the word of the gospel of Jesus, to give us comfort and confidence in the world of sin, death, and sorrow. For Jesus' sake, O God, have mercy upon us and bless us. Thanks for this past week and upholding this congregation in their vacancy and continuing to give hope and confidence that if thou art for them, who can be against them? And the confidence that in due time there will be a pastor given in thy love. Father, thanks for sustaining our elders and as they take up the work of family visitation this week with the desire of unity and peace in the congregation, strengthen them mightily in heart and hand to take up the work. And thanks, Lord, for our deacons, and as we give our offerings in a moment for the general fund and for the poor in the work of benevolence. Equip our deacons not only to collect, but then also with the greatest fidelity to preserve the mercies of Christ, and then, as necessary, with much wisdom and with comfortable words of Scripture, that they may cheerfully distribute to those who have need. And Lord, where judgments must be made according to the truth of thy word, give the deacons wisdom to come to good conclusions and to make judgments that are pleasing to thee as they do their work. Father, thanks for those who serve on the boards of our schools, so that there are not only all of the decisions that must be made on the day-to-day basis by administrator and teacher in the classroom and all those who labor in and on behalf of the school, but behind the scenes, men who are willing to serve on the board that oversees the school. And many decisions there must be made also, and some more difficult than others, and where the school board members must make sound judgments according to the principles of thy word, lead them that they may make good decisions for the cause of truth and righteousness, and that our schools may prosper. So bless these men in their labors. Father in heaven, equip all of us with the wisdom we need. Each believer here, through the course of any given week, we are often faced with many difficult decisions or situations where we're not always sure what to do or what not to do, what to say or what not to say, when to speak or when to be silent. We don't want to behave foolishly. We don't ever want to do anything that would give anyone an occasion to speak any evil of thee, of Christ, of the Bible, of the gospel, or of this church. So, Father, give us wisdom from on high to walk circumspectly, to be careful, to be diligent, to be faithful in all our interactions, that thy name may be glorified. And thanks for the promise that when we ask in faith, thou art a God who gives liberally. Father, bless thy servant this morning as he stands in this pulpit. Give to him all he needs to be able to lead this service in a way that is pleasing to thee, so that all of us together in heart may be lifted up and our hearts may be led to Christ at thy right hand, for it is to him that all the articles of our Christian faith and the particular article of the Heidelberg Catechism we consider this morning lead us, that the great Savior and Mediator may be honored this morning. And Father, may we all say in sincerity and in truth, he must increase, but I must decrease. Gracious God in heaven, pardon us of all of our iniquity. Forgive the sins we've committed already this morning, and then give us grace to be willing to forgive our brother or our sister, forgiving as we have been forgiven. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's give now for the general fund and the benevolent fund. Our next number is 121. Psalm 44, reflecting back on the days of Joshua, let us sing 1, 2, and 4. For our scripture reading this morning, we will read a number of passages, beginning with Joshua 5. Two books of the Bible this morning, Joshua and Hebrews. We'll begin with Joshua 5, verse 13, and read through 6, verse 2. Joshua 5, verse 13, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, art thou for us or for our adversaries? And he said, nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, what saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. Now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho and the king thereof and the mighty men of valor. Now let's page a few chapters later to 14, verse 1. Captain, warfare. Now chapter 14, verse 1. And these are the countries which the children of Israel inherited in the land of Canaan, which Eleazar the priest and Joshua the son of Nun and the heads of the fathers of the tribes of the children of Israel distributed for inheritance to them. Now to the New Testament, Hebrews. Hebrews 2. Hebrews 2, 9 through 11. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. And now we conclude with Hebrews 4, 1 through 11. Let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest. As he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. Seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Again, he limiteth a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? There remaineth, therefore, a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. Thus far, we read the divinely inspired scriptures, and it's on the basis of those passages in all of scripture that we have the instruction of Lord's Day 11 of the Heidelberg Catechism. Why is the Son of God called Jesus, that is a Savior? Because he saveth us and delivereth us from our sins. And likewise, because we ought not to seek, neither can find salvation in any other. Do such then believe in Jesus, the only Savior, who seek their salvation and welfare of saints of themselves or anywhere else? They do not, for though they boast of him in words, yet in deeds they deny Jesus, the only deliverer and Savior. For one of these two things must be true, either that Jesus is not a complete Savior, or that they who by a true faith receive this Savior must find all things in him necessary to their salvation. Let's ask God's blessing in prayer. Father, give us faith now. We don't want to hear thy word according to the unbelief of our flesh. So work faith in us that we may embrace the word of Jesus Christ as it is spoken to us, and embrace with a lively faith for rest and for the glory of thy name. Grant it for Jesus' sake. Amen. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, we take a unique approach to the Heidelberg Catechism this morning by explaining the doctrine of Lord's Day 11 by means of Old Testament typology. God eternally conceived of the full reality of the covenant of grace in Jesus. But God did not immediately reveal the full realization and perfection of that covenant in Jesus. There was progress through history as the covenant promise of God was unfolded through the ages of covenant history, so that we have a distinction in history between the Old Testament and the New Testament, between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And the Old Dispensation was one of types, shadows, figures, pictures, and the New Dispensation is one of reality. A type. Way back in the Old Testament now, a type is some God-ordained person, event, institution that is real in itself, it has significance in itself, but ultimately it's pointing to the new dispensation and some aspect of God's covenant of grace in Jesus. So that when Jesus comes, he is the fulfillment of all these types, these shadows, these pictures of old. And the main point of the book of Hebrews is that Jesus is better. Jesus is superior to everything in the old dispensation. And so the urgent word to the Jewish Christians of the new dispensation was, don't cave into the pressure of these unbelieving Jews who want to take you back into all the external things of the Judaism of the Old Testament. Don't cave into them. Embrace with a true and living faith Jesus. Jesus is better. Jesus is superior because Jesus is the reality, the fulfillment of all these things of old. The Bible itself teaches this distinction between type of old and reality today. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 11. Now all these things, for example, drinking water from the rock. Now all these things happen unto them for ensamples, figures, forms, types. And they are written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the world are come. Old Testament, full of ensamples. Hebrews 9, 23 and 24. It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ is not entered into holy places made with hands, which are figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Old Testament, full of figures of the true. This morning we turn our attention to Lord's Day 11 of the Heidelberg Catechism, which explains this article of our confession in the Apostles' Creed, I believe in Jesus. So question 29, why is the Son of God called Jesus? Question 30, do such then believe in Jesus? We may not learn of Jesus only from the New Testament, though often that's easier. We must learn of Jesus from the Bible, the whole Bible, which includes the Old Testament. Jesus himself said to the Jews, according to John 5, verse 39, search the Scriptures. And in that day, all they had was the Old Testament. Search the scriptures, for in them you think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Old Testament, full of Jesus by way of typology. So this morning, we want to learn of Jesus, our only Savior, through this one type, the person Joshua, who in his name, his position, and his work was a figure, a picture, a type of our true Joshua, Jesus. So we take as our theme, our true Joshua. Let's look first at type. We'll look at the typology of the Old Testament. Second, reality. We'll come to the catechism and the reality of Jesus. And then third, we'll conclude with the confession the catechism wants us to make. So type, reality, confession. Joshua was a type of Jesus. Now we don't get to determine who or what is a type. The Bible must teach us who or what is a type. And almost never does the scripture explicitly say about a type what it says of Adam in Romans 5 verse 14. Who is a figure of him that was to come. Nevertheless, there's evidence in the scripture. And when we identify something as a type, we need to gather and collect all of the evidence, piece it together, and now we have the ground on which we can stand saying, in this case, Joshua was a type of Jesus. First, that Joshua was a type of Jesus is evident from the fact that God ordained that Nun and his wife, when they had their baby boy, would name him Joshua, so that we come to know him as Joshua, the son of Nun. That Old Testament Hebrew name Joshua means Jehovah salvation. And the New Testament Greek equivalent is Jesus, Jehovah salvation. So Joshua and Jesus have the exact same name. Now that all by itself is not proof that Joshua was a type of Jesus, because many Hebrew boys may have had the name Joshua. But this fact combined with others makes clear he's a type of Jesus. Second, that Joshua was a type of Jesus is evident from the fact that in one place, Scripture calls Joshua Jesus. Hebrews 4 verse 8. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? And the writer of the Hebrews here is speaking of the history of Israel entering into the promised land by Joshua. And the writer calls Joshua Jesus, because in the old dispensation, when the people looked at Joshua, they could see a very clear picture of Jesus. Third, that Joshua is a type of Jesus is evident from the fact that both Joshua and Jesus occupied the same position among God's people, warring captain. Joshua was captain. Deuteronomy 3 verse 28, but charge Joshua and encourage him and strengthen him, for he shall go over before this people, and he shall cause them to enter into the land which thou shalt see. And then you read the book of Joshua, and the whole book of Joshua reveals how he is the one who commanded the people and as a captain led them into their inheritance. So that we read in Joshua 6 verse 2 that the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho. Joshua would go before the people as their captain. Jesus is our captain. We read at the end of Joshua 5 how a man came to Joshua, and that man was the captain of the host of the Lord, and Joshua fell down and worshiped him. So he wasn't a mere man. He was the angel of Jehovah, the pre-incarnate Christ. We could even say Christ himself in the old dispensation, captain of the host of the Lord, the captain, meeting Joshua, captain. And then that's confirmed in Hebrews 2, verse 10, which we read, where Jesus is there called the captain of our salvation made perfect through suffering. Both captains. So in the Old Testament, you have Moses, and when the people look at him, they can see mediator, deliverer, Jesus. And you have David, when the people look at him, they can see King Jesus coming. And when they looked at Joshua, they saw the Messiah who was to come as captain. Fourth, that Joshua was a type of Jesus is evident from the fact that each one of them, Joshua, Jesus as captain, led the people into their inheritance. We read Joshua 14, verse 1, which with many other verses speaks of Joshua distributing the land as an inheritance for the people. And then go to the New Testament. We read in Acts 26 of Paul recounting how Jesus appeared to him on the way to Damascus. And Jesus told Paul, I've called you to be the preacher unto the Gentiles. Go preach the gospel to the nations. Acts 26, verse 18. This is what our Lord said to Paul, that they, Gentiles, may receive the forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by the faith that is in me. So we receive an inheritance through faith in Jesus. Now let's put this all together. Joshua is a type of Jesus by being a captain who led the people into their inheritance by conquest. First, that physical land of Canaan was the inheritance of rest. When Israel came out of Egypt and they went through the wilderness, they came to this new land called Canaan, but they had no natural right to take possession of that land and dispossess the Canaanites of that land, but it was God's land. It was God's inheritance that he freely gave the people so that they could live in covenant fellowship with their God in his land, Canaan. Inheritance. And the outstanding characteristic of that inheritance is that it was the land of rest. Hebrews 3 speaks of the 40 long years in the wilderness. And the chapter concludes with verse 19. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. They couldn't enter in. Enter into what? Canaan, the promised land, what? They couldn't enter in. Next verse, chapter 4, verse 1. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. The land, the inheritance, it was a land of rest. There was no rest for the people under the tyranny and the whip of Pharaoh. There was no rest for them in that waste howling wilderness and all of the trouble of the wilderness as they journeyed through that hot, dry desert with no food or water. But God promised them, keep going. Up ahead is Canaan, and it's a land of rest for you. It's a land flowing with milk and honey, and there you will dwell alone with me. I will be your God, and you will be my people. It's rest. So we sang in Psalter 292, stanzas 3 and 4, wandering in the wilderness, far they roam the desert way, found no settled dwelling place, where in peace secure to stay. Till, with thirst and hunger pressed, courage sank within their breast. To Jehovah then they cried in their trouble, and he saved. He himself became their guide, led them to the rest they craved. Inheritance of rest. Second, because that promised inheritance of rest was occupied by the wicked Canaanites, it had to be taken by conquest. So you read through the book of Joshua and you find all kinds of warfare. For example, chapter 8, Israel smote 12,000 inhabitants of Ai. In Joshua 8 tells us the story, and there was swords, spears, fire, smoke, ambushes, pursuits, slayings, and a king hanging from a tree. But how could they do that, the Israelites, when they had no trained army, they had no horses, no chariots, all this warfare? Well, later the Israelites would sing about those days, what we sang in Psalter 121, stanza 2. They gained not the land by the edge of the sword. Their own arm to them could no safety afford. But thy right hand saved, in the light of thy face, because of thy favor and wonderful grace. And then before Joshua died, Joshua gathered all the people together. Come. Brothers and sisters, look at the land now in which we dwell, all having our inheritance. And you see all that blood dried on all the sword tips? All this warfare? How did we get this land? Joshua 23, verse 3, and ye have seen all that the Lord your God hath done unto all these nations because of you. For the Lord your God is he that hath fought for you. They fought, but God fought and gave them the victory. An inheritance of rest to be taken by conquest. And now third, God gave them that victory in the land through Captain Joshua. Read the book of Joshua and be impressed by Joshua and how he's the subject of so many different action verbs. I'll give you just a little taste. And Joshua spake. Commanded, arose, sent, called, set up, pitched, chose, stretched out, rent, drew, burnt, built, read, ascended, smote, slew, made war, cast. Captain Joshua. And if any man said, I don't need Joshua, and I'm not following Joshua, I know the way. I'm going into the land my own way. I've taken 5,000 soldiers from my tribe. We're going in our own way. We don't need Joshua. Not only would that man be a fool, that man would be destroyed. God appointed Joshua. Joshua was the captain. Joshua brought them into the land. Joshua led them in the conquest of the Canaanites. And to none other than Joshua did God say, I have given into thy hand Jericho. Captain Joshua. Here it is, one more time, all put together. Joshua was a type of Jesus by being the captain who led the people into their inheritance of rest by conquest. Joshua was a type of Jesus, our true Joshua, the captain who leads us into the promised spiritual rest of God's covenantal inheritance by conquest. Jesus, the reality. Lord's Day 11 teaches us really two main points about Jesus this morning. Number one, salvation is in Jesus. What do you need to know about Jesus? Salvation is in Him. He's Savior. Question 29. Why is the Son of God called Jesus, that is a Savior? Because He saveth us and delivereth us from our sins. And likewise, because we ought not to seek, neither can find salvation in any other. Question 30. Do such then believe in Jesus, the only Savior, who seek their salvation and welfare of saints, of themselves, or anywhere else? They do not. For though they boast of Him in words, yet in deeds they deny Jesus, the only Deliverer and Savior. For one of these two things must be true, either that Jesus is not a complete Savior, or that they who by a true faith receive this Savior must find all things in Him necessary to their salvation. That's clear. Jesus, Savior. And all the Roman Catholics could stand up and say, Amen. Here's the second main point of the Catechism. He is the only Savior, the exclusive Savior, so that there is salvation nowhere else. Answer 29, because we ought not to seek, neither can find salvation in any other. Question 30, do such then believe in Jesus, the only Savior, who seek their salvation and welfare of saints, of themselves, or anywhere else? They do not, for though they boast of Him in words, yet in deeds they deny Jesus, the only Deliverer and Savior. For one of these two things must be true, either that Jesus is not a complete Savior, or that they who by a true faith receive this Savior must find all things in Him necessary to their salvation. Savior. Only Savior. Now let's go back to the typology and see how it points to the reality Jesus, and in that reality, the two main points of the Catechism will stand out. Savior and only Savior. Working with that typology, first, the salvation, that's the word of the Catechism, the salvation that we have in Captain Jesus is deliverance from sin and into the covenantal inheritance of spiritual rest. Rest. True rest is knowing and enjoying peace with God. True rest is not being cuddled up on the couch with a blanket, lying in bed, or being stretched out in a hammock between two palms in the tropics. There are people lying in bed right now. And there are people stretched out in hammocks right now who don't have rest, who are restless in the soul because of the guilt of their sins, and they know they're not right with God. And maybe that's true of someone here this morning, that you're restless within. Why? Because you are not right with God. And if you're not right with God, then you do not have true rest. There's something worse than being under Pharaoh and his whip. And it's being under the whip of your conscience, which is lashing you with the stripes of condemnation. There's something worse than being in that waste howling wilderness with the heat and no food and nothing to drink. And it's what David describes in Psalm 32 as having all of the moisture of my soul, all the inner spiritual life of my soul being turned into the drought of summer because the heavy hand of God's displeasure is upon me as a guilty sinner. I have no rest. There's something worse than having the Amalekites come up from the rear and picking off some of the women and the children as they did. And that's having the power of your own sinfulness, the power of your sinful flesh, constantly buffeting you and warring against the spirit within you. I have no rest. And now here's Joshua in the old dispensation. Joshua could lead the people into Canaan. You can lie down in the green meadows, and you can lie down beside the still waters, and you can eat sweet honey, and you can drink milk, but even that experience would never give to the true believing Israelite satisfaction and rest because of the guilt and the power and the shame of their sins. Joshua couldn't lead them into true rest. Hebrews 4, verse 8, "For if Jesus, Joshua, had given them rest, then why would he not afterward have spoken of another day?" The man, Joshua, he couldn't lead anyone out of the guilt of their sin. And he couldn't lead anyone. He couldn't lead himself. He couldn't bring his own soul into the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, into the true covenantal inheritance of God. Joshua was a faithful man by the grace of God. He was a faithful attendant of Moses early on. He was one of the spies who came back with a good report of faith. He was the one who led them in the conquest of the Canaanites. He was a faithful man, but he's only a type. And like every type, he fails. He cannot. And if he cannot, Mary cannot. And if he cannot, the Pope cannot. And if he cannot, you cannot, I cannot, our ancestors cannot. No one can take us out of sin and bring us into that delightful rest of God's inheritance for us. But our true Joshua can, and he does, the captain of our salvation. There's that marvelous inheritance. It's called the covenant of grace. And in that covenant, God has a place for each one of his people, and God will bring us into that inheritance where we have a place with him now and eternally in the heavenly Canaan. And Jesus is the one who brings us in. In Jesus and Jesus alone is there justification, the pardon of all of our sins, and the reception of his perfect imputed righteousness. In Jesus and Jesus alone, we enjoy communion with God so that we're not afraid of God. They are. They were terrified, the Canaanites, terrified of God. In Jesus, I'm not afraid of God. In fact, the closer I press toward him by faith, the happier I am. I'm not afraid of you Canaanites, and I'm not afraid of tomorrow and what it will bring. Not in Jesus. And in Jesus and Jesus alone, we have transformation, so that we are transformed from the image of the devil, like all those Canaanites, and we are conformed unto his image, the image of God's dear Son, so that we know God by faith, that we love God, and we can walk humbly with our God in grateful obedience. In our Captain Jesus. The Heidelberg Catechism speaks of salvation, deliverance, and welfare. To use the language of the Old Testament, it's coming in to the rest of our covenantal inheritance by Captain Jesus. And now, secondly, Captain Jesus, our true Joshua, brings us into our rest by conquest. As the captain of our salvation, he had to war. Constantly war. So he came into our flesh, and now living among us, he had to war with the devil, for example, especially during those temptations in the wilderness. He was constantly warring against the chief priests, the scribes, and the Pharisees with all of their hatred and opposition. But the battle was the fiercest when he was hanging from that tree on Golgotha. There was that tree, and hanging on that tree, there was no rest. That's not a tree of rest, but intense, inexpressible, and hellish agony under the judgment of God, because Captain was bearing the guilt of our sins. And in order for him to make an atonement to God, in order for him to satisfy divine justice, in order for him to obtain, the Israelites had no right to that physical inheritance. We have no right to God's inheritance. In order for him to obtain that eternal inheritance, while hanging on that tree, he had to consecrate the whole of his being perfectly unto God in love, moment by moment, while God's curse was bearing down upon him in body and soul. There was no rest there. And then you add to that the fact that he was surrounded by the enemies, by principalities and powers and the rulers of darkness and spiritual wickedness in high places, surrounded by that old arch enemy Satan, who is trying to conquer the captain on the cross, to try to turn his soul, his heart against God, to bring him into despair, to cause him to despair, even to the point of aborting his mission of saving his people, come down from that cross. There was an incomprehensible warfare that was playing out over the terrain of Jesus' real human soul that makes contending with flesh and blood Canaanites with a literal sword seem like child play. It was warfare on that cross, but he's not mere Joshua of old. He's the Son of God. By the power of his Godhead, he sustained in his body and soul all that wrath of God and bore it away. And he poured out his soul as an offering for sin. And he did satisfy the justice of God. And he died. And so he was taken and he was buried in the lower parts of the earth and bound and fastened in the chains of death. What did Captain do on the first day of the week? He broke through the chains of death. He emerged victoriously out of the grave. We celebrate that today. It's Sunday, the first day of the week. And he destroyed him. Hebrews 2 verse 14. Destroyed him that had the power of death, even Satan. Conquering he was, going forth to conquer. And he has obtained the inheritance of rest for us. And now that captain, he leads us into that rest by giving us faith to fight the battle of faith. He's a marvelous captain. He comes by his Spirit and he fights through the front lines and through the middle lines and through the back lines of all our inner depravity. No one can do it, but he does. He fights all the way through by his Spirit and he comes into our heart and he sets up his citadel and his throne from which he will rule. And he unites us to himself so that we are bone of captain's bone and we are flesh of captain's flesh, as no Israelite ever was to Joshua. And he gives us faith to believe in him. And now every day is the battle of faith. As we seek to enjoy that rest in God's covenant, in the battle against guilt, and maybe you're feeling guilty this morning, we don't look to our own hands and what we can do. We will only add to our debt and increase our restlessness. We look to Captain Jesus and we cry out to God, "Oh God, I am so sorry for all of my sins. Now sprinkle my conscience with the blood of my captain and soothe me with the peace of the gospel." He does, for Jesus' sake. Every day is the battle of faith, battling against the power of sin and temptation. Let's say the power of a hot temper, and maybe we couldn't escape it this past week. The power of sexual lust that we were not able to control this past week. The power of soul entangling greed. Couldn't control it, couldn't escape it. The power of doubting and fearing and always being plagued day after day with all these fears that trouble me. The power of being stubborn and being rebellious to dad and mom, and this past week, having a big mouth to dad and mom. The power of ingratitude and constantly complaining. Sin is powerful, and now we don't look to our own hands, but we look to the captain of our salvation, and we plead, "Oh God, it's Sunday morning, I'm here in thy house, and I'm weary because of the power of sin within me. Breathe the spirit of my captain into my soul more and more, that I may take up the battle of daily conversion and mortify that old man. And quicken the new man." Jesus is the captain of our salvation, and he leads us daily into the inheritance of true rest in God's covenant by faith and in the way of daily conversion. I believe in Jesus. That's our confession this morning, coming out of the Catechism, which ultimately is coming out of the Apostles' Creed. So we can all say it together tonight. I believe in Jesus. I believe in Jesus, my Savior. I believe in Jesus, the only Savior, the complete Savior. The heathen man will not say it. I believe in Jesus. The ungodly intellectual and educated man in the halls of academia this week, he will not say it. I believe in Jesus. The proud papist, the proud Arminian, the proud professing Christian might say, I believe in Jesus, but then look for salvation in somewhere else in addition to Jesus. Boasting, says the Catechism. Answer 30, they do not, for though they boast of him in words. And there we would all be but for the grace of God, and by his almighty grace, the true believer confesses, I believe in Jesus and Jesus alone. For all my salvation. The Israelites never said that about Joshua. I believe in Joshua. They didn't say that. I believe in the Messiah. And we today, I believe in Jesus. So let's confess that this morning. And believing in Him, enjoy the rest that God has given. Boys and girls, you confess it also. I believe in Jesus. I know He died on the cross to take away all my sins. And I believe that Jesus leads me into the love of God. I'm a little boy. I'm a little girl. But I say, I believe God loves me for Jesus' sake. And I know those boys and girls went through the Jordan behind Joshua and those priests, and they went into the promised land of Canaan. And though I'm a little boy, I'm a little girl, I believe that when I die, Jesus will take me into heaven. Let's all confess it this week. I believe in Jesus. No matter where we may be by God's providence and whom we may meet, maybe God will give us an opportunity to answer someone's question. Why do you believe in Jesus? I want to tell you about Jesus. And this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to the Bible. I'm going to show you all the action verbs of which Jesus is the subject. And they're so rich and beautiful and so many. And the Heidelberg Catechism now is going to lead us deeper into the Apostles' Creed. And we're not only going to learn more about who Jesus is, but what He did and what He keeps on doing. And it far surpasses anything Joshua ever did. And maybe we can go home this morning and come up with some action verbs of which Jesus is the subject. Jesus, Savior, only Savior, we will say it. I believe in Jesus, our true Joshua. Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, to Thee be the glory for the revelation of Him, our Savior, and for the grace of faith that we believe in Him, and for the grace of loosing our tongues that we may say so. And now may we say it. In His name we pray. Amen. Let's sing 162 as our response and confession. And you look for these two elements: Jesus, Savior; Jesus, only Savior. Both stanzas of 162.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the communion of the Holy Ghost abide with you forever. Amen.